Starting this demo, I would like to understand one thing. I could see one student and three working persons in the current session, right? Correct me if I'm wrong. I think Hashmi is the only student and rest all are working professionals. Am I right? How I would be dealing this course? Okay. Are you able to see the document or yes, you could see this PDF document, right? Oracle Business Intelligence Service. Yeah, I got a positive response from Harsha. Okay, so I'm moving on. Duration of this course is like 20 days, more than 60 to 90 minutes class per day. It varies according to the topic I take up. There are only two prerequisites, like participant should have at least 1 year of experience as an application developer. Though it is not a fast and hard rule like having an experience, it is better to have 1 year of experience because we will get to know how the projects would be dealt and we will get to know how the requirements would be. That's why I have put this as a prerequisite. And more important thing is a participant should have a knowledge of relational database and SQL because as it is a reporting tool and as you know reports are all based on SQL, having good knowledge of RDBMS and SQL is very much necessary. Mode of training is online training as Sanjay said, and agenda I have split the entire course into 11 modules, 12 modules to be precise. First module is a basic introduction of a data warehouse, and then I would be dealing OBI 11G product overview and architecture. Later, I would show you the steps how to install OBIE. There are three different ways to install OBIE. My PDF dot class per day for nearly 20 days. And prerequisites having 1 year of experience and most importantly good knowledge of RDBMS and SQL. Mode of training as Sanjay said online training, and I have split this course into 12 modules. First one is basic introduction of data warehouse and all other basic terminology, and then I would be dealing 11G overview and architecture. Architecture plays a major role in OBI 11G because till 10G, WebLogic was not into the picture, but 11G, OBI is centered around WebLogic server, and there are many features related to WebLogic server which plays a key role in Fusion middleware. As you are aware, OBI is part of Fusion middleware, so knowing about architecture is very much necessary and it helps to carry out administrative activities. And then I would be dealing installation of a 11G installation. As I said earlier, I would not be installing it on your machine. I would be sharing detailed steps and how to install. You have to install it on your laptops. And then I would be dealing RPD design and modeling. This is the crux of the course, RPD design and modeling, on basing on which we would be starting we would be start working on the labs. Till module 2 there won't be any labs. From module 3 there would be exercises to do so that we can learn it in much better way. And then Harsha, I got a question from you from where we have to download. Sanjay would be helping on you regarding this agenda details. Let me continue with the demo. You can get the document from Sanjay. And then I would be dealing with certain features like aggregate persistence wizard in 11G. Till here we would be dealing with the OBI metadata, and then we will go on to the analysis. It is the presentation layer, I can say UI of the application. Okay, we will be working on analysis, dashboards, and action links, guided navigation, conditions, etc. And I will also explain, even for analysis dashboards, I would be providing lab exercises for you guys. and all the necessary artifacts will also be given for the lab exercises. Only the thing is you need to install OVL11G on your machines, and then I would be dealing delivers and agents. You will get to know what is a deliver mean and what is an agent. Okay, this is I'm just going through the agenda, and then I would be dealing security, cache management, and multi-user development environment. And then I will explain how OVL11G will be upgraded. I mean, how upgrading from 10G to 11G. And the last module is of least importance because merging and importing from different repositories is a feature that is available in 11G. I would be dealing it as a theory, but there won't be any exercises as such. Each module may take one or more classes depending on the content, and detailed steps would be given how to install, but actual installation should be done by the student himself. And please make sure that your laptop system are adhering to the system requirements mentioned by Oracle. Regard as slides, but I will share them as PDF files. As for this course, Sanjay, can I do for this course or like technical business analysts, configurators, developers, database administrators? Okay, and the goal of this course is to enable students to install, design, customize, and configuration applications using OVL11G. Okay, I would be explaining recommended methodology by Oracle and also best practices to have successful implementations. And the agenda of this course is basics of data warehouse. As a part of this, I would be explaining what is an OLTP application and what is an OLAP application as well. As you all very well know, there are two major ways to organize data, that is transactional systems or analytical systems. Before going further, I would like to explain what is a transactional system and what is an analytical system. See, transactional, by the name itself you can understand. I will explain it using an example. If you take any bank login bank application, for example HDFC net banking, if you log into that bank application, you can see how much balance is there in the savings account, and if you transfer any money from your account to your friend's account, instantly that value would be deducted from your account. So these are like transactions which are done online. So these kind of applications are called online transaction processing. Not only a banking application, if you take any Vodafone application, if any of you guys have any Vodafone or any other telephone provider postpaid connection, you can log into your account and check your usage, bills, and payment history, etc. All these things maintain your data, and whatever transactions are being done would be saved in the database. These applications are write intensive, in the sense that you would be either inserting a record in the database or updating a record. Updating in the sense, in case of bank application, you would be updating the bank balance if you transfer some amount to your friend, right? If, for example, if you take telephone application, okay, like Vodafone application, after you had made any payment, in the payment history, you can see another record saying that you have paid certain amount on, say, August 1st, 2014. A new record has been entered, right? This is like inserting a record. So basically, applications can be divided into two types, OLTP and OLAP. So far I have explained OLTP, online transactional processing, which means write intensive applications. And we have another system called analytical for online transaction processing. We would be using transactional systems as a database beneath that application. For online analytic processing applications, you would be using analytical systems at the database level. Okay. So for analytical systems, the main purpose is to organize data in optimized way so that queries can be executed on large data sets to generate a report. Before explaining this, I missed out explaining what is an OLAP application. See, if you take the same banking application, there if you want to get any history, bank statement of last 12 months, you have to select a certain link, and there they would be generating bank statement for the given period, say, let's say from June 2013 to July 31st 2014. There you would be generating a report. There you would not be inserting or updating any data into the application. This kind of reporting applications is called online analytical processing applications. These are all read intensive, not write intensive, because we are not updating any record or inserting any record. Okay, so I have explained both OLTP and OLAP in the same example using banking application, because it is very much nearer to our daily life. In reality, we would be having different applications. In this HDFC bank application, maybe we are getting this historical data from another application which is integrated in the OLTP application. That is why we are able to see reports in OLTP. No? You have to take a point that there are two kinds of applications. One is OLTP and other one is OLAP. For OLTP, the database that we are using underneath is transactional system, and for OLAP it is analytical system. For analytical system, there are different ways to different database modeling techniques to store data. Going forward, I would be explaining what are the differences technically at the database level between OLTP and OLAP, and what are the normalization levels that are there in OLTP and OLAP. Before going to that, let me explain what is a data warehouse. See, earlier we had seen what is an OLTP and what is the database underneath that application. Transactional systems and for OLAP, analytical systems. Analytical systems are like it is a data warehouse where we can have we can understand data in a more meaningful way. See, there is a clear distinction between data and information. Data means it is a composition of observable and recordable facts. Okay, but information is an integrated collection of facts and is used as the basis for decision making. We need reports to make a decision. That's where OLAP applications come into the picture and the data warehouse. As I mentioned here, electronic storage of large amount of information by a business is called data warehousing. The advantage of data warehouse is it is subject oriented, it is time variant, it is easily accessible and non-volatile. What is subject-oriented, what is non-volatile, time variant? You can understand when I explain differences between OLTP and OLAP. As I explained earlier, a transactional schema optimized for read and write and you can see multiple joins. These are like tables. If we have 5 tables, we can have a relationship between tables with multiple joins. But if you take OLAP schema, the schema would be optimized in such a way that we can query data from large data sets. So for such schemas, we would be using certain data modeling techniques like dimensional modeling. Here you could see the arrangement of tables in a form of star. This is called star schema. Star schema is one of the data modeling techniques used in data warehousing. I'm stressing on the OLTP and OLAP because it is very much necessary to understand why OLAP databases use dimensional modeling like star schema or snowflake schema, such data model techniques, which is way different from OLTP. As I said earlier, OLTP manages individual transactions. OLAP responds to analysis queries. It is write intensive to OLTP. OLAP is read intensive. In OLTP or database, we will be having constant updates, inserts and deletes. Whereas in OLAP, there won't be any change to the data that frequently. The data would be very static in nature. Either the daily batch jobs or weekly batch jobs would be affecting the data, not the application. Here queries return small data sets, and for OLAP, queries would be returned in large data sets. Data is highly aggregated and it is pre-calculated for reporting. For OLTP, there won't be any kind of aggregation. Even if we have aggregation, very little aggregation would be there. Reports require calculation in OLTP. In the sense, the application has to calculate from the raw data that it got from the database. In case of OLAP, there would be a semantic layer between application and database which would be doing the calculation. That is why I said data is pre-calculated for reporting. Data is optimized for storage and read and write performance. Here in OLAP, data is optimized for query performance because we would be returning very large data sets in order to display reports. In that case, we need query performance to be very very robust in nature. So data is optimized in that way. Here data is relatively normalized. For OLAP, it is denormalized. You guys are aware of normalization, right? Normalization from 1NF, 2NF, 3NF, so and so forth. Usually we would be having normalized data in OLTP, but denormalized data in OLAP schemas. Because if we have denormalized data in OLTP schemas, writing or updating any data into the schemas would be very cumbersome and it may lead to errors. So it should be very normalized, then only we can have it as a write intensive schema. In case of OLAP schemas, if it is highly normalized, the queries performance would be very bad and report generation would take long durations. So we need, as it is read intensive, we need it to be very denormalized state instead of having higher normalizations. Just give me a second. Next, as I have shown in the previous figure, we will be having multiple joins in OLTP schema. But for OLAP, there will be minimum number of joins. It would be very simple, as you have seen earlier, it is like a star. OLTP applications are used for data entry and retrieval, but for in case of OLAP, these schemas would be used for reports, charts and pivot tables. Reports, charts and pivot tables means, see, as I said, OLAP schemas are used for reporting tools. Reporting tools means you would be generating reports. It might include some charts. For example, if you want to see attendance of a class, attendance of students in a particular class throughout the year, starting from July to April of the academic year. If you want to show it in a bar graph, it would be more easier to understand than having it in a tabular format, right? So in reporting, we can have charts as well, and we have another kind of table which is called pivot table. If you are aware of pivot tables in Excel, then I don't need to explain. If you are not aware of pivot table in Excel sheet, then I would be explaining it while taking up analysis and dashboards. The Siebel, PeopleSoft, SAP, etc. are examples for OLTP applications. OBIE, Cognos, ClickView, etc. are the examples for OLAP applications. So coming to dimensional modeling, it is a technique to organize business data logically that helps end users understand it in a better way. Here, the dimensional modeling technique we use for OLAP schemas is there are majorly three types, like star schema, snowflake schema and fact constellation schema. Star schema, see, for majorly I will explain it using an example. For example, we need to display a report which shows sales by product and by month. Okay, if we have data in such a way, like they are divided into facts and dimensions, then we can have this query executed very easily. So star schema is used in this kind of reporting. What is a star schema? Star schema means the warehouse, the tables are divided into majorly two types. One is a fact table and other one is dimension table. Fact table means is a table which contain all the metrics. Metrics in the sense all the numeric values. And dimension tables contain all attributes which qualify these metrics. See, in this example, I have sales, products and month. So sales is a metric value, so it comes under fact. So we are qualifying this fact using a two dimensions called product and month. So if basically in a schema, if we have a table which is centered and surrounded by dimension tables, in the sense having a fact table in between surrounded by dimension tables, then it is called star schema. Here you can see this is fact table and it is surrounded by dimension tables. There won't be any relation between the dimension tables, but relation from dimension table will be with only the fact table that is centered in the schema. As I said earlier, all those things which are metrics, which are quantifiable, which are editable, those come under fact, like dollars, unit shipments, and all those attributes which can qualify facts come under dimension tables. See, this is an example for star schema. For example, we have a scenario, say we want to have reporting on sales facts. Okay, like for example, we have different branches with us. Okay, and we have some let's say it is some what can I say? Some re if we have some retail stores and there are and multiple branches for retail stores, and if we have certain items and you can see these details can be captured in tables in such a way that all the line items, the number of items that are sold and cost of each item, all these numeric values will be stored in a fact table, and all attribute columns, all attributes will be stored in dimension tables. For example, attributes related to branch would be stored in this table, branch name, branch type, and attributes related to the address are stored in this location table, location, street, city, province, country, and attributes related to time, in the sense on which day this invoice is being generated, month, quarter, year, other all other attributes related to time are stored in this time table, and attributes related to item, what is the item name, which of what is the brand, what is the type, who is the supplier and who is the supplier type, this can be stored in dimension table for item, and all the facts like what is the branch key and what is how many units are being sold, what how much dollars has been registered on this invoice, all these numeric values are stored in this fact table. As you can see, there won't be any relation between the dimension tables. We would be having only relation with the dimension table and the centrally located fact table. And there is another technique called snowflake schema. Snowflake schema is like normalizing one or more dimensions so that there will be like a tail to this star schema. Then it is called snowflake schema. See, as I explained earlier, we have time, branch, location, item, dimension tables, and we have one fact table, that is sales fact table. If location is normalized a bit, then it is called snowflaked at location dimension table. See, here we have only details related to street and city. Okay, and all other details from city, province and country are stored in another table. Likewise for item, we have only supplier key, but all other details related to supplier would be stored in another table called the supplier type, supplier name, etc. in another table. This kind of normalization done on any dimensions in the star schema would make star schema into a snowflake schema. Fact constellation is like if you have multiple facts and it can be multiple fact or single fact. If you have a common fact between two star schemas, or if you have multiple facts and having one or few of such facts as common facts between one or more multiple star schemas, then it will be a fact constellation schema. See, here you can see two stars, right? One is with sales fact table, and dimensions are time dimension, item dimension, shipping dimension, and we have another star schema, that is fact with fact table, sales fact, branch, location as dimension tables. And we have another fact table, that is shipping fact table, which has dimensions shipper, time dimension and item dimension. And out of these dimensions, time dimension is a common dimension between sales fact and shipping fact table, and also item dimension is common to sales fact and shipping fact table. So basically, having multiple star schemas with common dimension tables would make it as a fact constellation schema. These common dimensions are called conformed dimension. A conformed dimension is a dimension that has same meaning to every fact table in the structure. If you consider the previous example, if you take time dimension, it is having same meaning for sales fact table and also for shipping fact table. See, here in this example, I have taken a three fact tables: shipment, sales order, and service request facts. And for all these three fact tables, customer dimension and product dimension would be having same meaning. Conformed dimensions are very much necessary in data warehouses, because if we get data from different sources and if we need to generate any report, bringing data from different sources, conformed dimensions would be of great help. So far in dimension modeling techniques, we have seen three types of schemas: star schema, snowflake schema, and fact constellation schema. And as I explained earlier, in dimension modeling, it is a type of data modeling technique. In dimension modeling, we have two types of tables majorly, that is a fact table and dimension table. Apart from fact and dimension tables, we have another kind of table called hierarchies. Hierarchies are very much necessary for reporting applications, because it helps us to drill up or drill down. I will explain what is a drill up and drill down while dealing RPD design. Let me explain what are different types of hierarchies we have. We have four types of hierarchies: level based hierarchy, parent child hierarchy, ragged, and skip level hierarchy. Level based hierarchies is a first kind of hierarchy and very simple in nature. If we have fixed number of levels in any hierarchy, then it is called level based hierarchy. For example, if you take any employee example, if we have CEOs under CEO, if there are regional managers, under regional managers we might have delivery managers, under delivery managers group leaders, under group leaders managers, under managers team members. See, we can see a fixed number of levels in each leg of the hierarchy. This kind of hierarchies are called level based. First level we have CEO, second level we have regional managers, third level delivery managers, fourth level group leader, fifth level managers, sixth and last level it is the team members. If we have a table with six columns, let's say level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4, level 5, level 6, and having data stored in such a way with this number of levels, then it is called level based hierarchy. Suppose if we have data stored in parent child format, for example, if we have only employee ID and manager ID, two columns, if we don't have any columns like level 1, level 2, level 3 and so on. For example, employee Ravi would be having a manager Sesi, employee ID in one row, and again manager is an employee of the organization. His record would be stored beneath the first record, like Sesi, employee name, and manager name would be someone else. So this kind of recursive relation within the table is called parent-child hierarchy. See, here you could see a regular level hierarchy, a balanced tree, okay. Even in parent-child hierarchy, it is a balanced tree, but the thing is, we would be storing the data in the table differently. Instead of having level columns, we would be having a parent column and a child column. Apart from these two, there are two types of hierarchies available in database. One is RAGD hierarchy and other one is skip level hierarchy. What is a RAGD hierarchy? For example, if the tree is not in a balanced structure, if you consider this diagram, see at the third level there are no nodes in this hierarchy. A leaf node for the second leg is at the second level itself, but whereas leaf nodes for the first leg is at the third level. So if a tree is not in balanced structure, then it is called RAGD hierarchy. In the sense, leaf nodes, having leaf nodes at different levels is called RAGD hierarchy. Whereas skip level hierarchy means a level would be skipped. See here, there is a leaf node at third level, but he is directly reporting to the manager who is at the first level. This kind of hierarchies where certain levels might be skipped are called skip level hierarchies. And we have learned what is a dimension and what is a fact. Here, let's discuss about slowly changing dimensions. What is a slowly changing dimension? Usually dimensions are not, they are very consistent and they won't get changed that frequently. For example, if we take any marital status of an employee, it won't change most likely, right? But if there's any change in such dimensions, then they are called slowly changing dimensions. If it is, if not marital status, let's take address. If an employee changes from current address to a new address, then if he updates it in the employee portal, this kind of dimensions would change slowly has to be captured in a way so that reports won't display stale data. So in a data warehouse, apart from facts, dimensions, hierarchies, we have another kind of table that is called slowly changing dimension. There are three types to handle these kind of tables. First type is overwriting, second type is creating another dimension record, and third type is creating a current value record. Type 1. Type 1 means having overwriting the value of the column. For example, if let's take address example. We have a column saying address, storing the address of the employee. If the address is being changed, if we overwrite that value under address column, then it is called type 1. Instead of overwriting, if we create another record, in this case the employee would be having two records, one record with address with old address and another record with new address. But in order to identify which record is valid, there will be a flag, like active flag, which differentiates, which highlights the valid record. So in type 2, when address is being changed, in the first record, the active flag is set to N and a new record would be inserted with new address value in the address column with active flag Y. this is called type 2. In type 3, we would be creating a new value. Instead of having a new record, we can have a new column itself, like new address, a current address, old address. If an employee changes address, that old address would be moved to the column called old address. Current address would be updated with the new address. So in these three ways, slowly changing dimensions can be dealt. And we have another kind of table called aggregate tables. If you carefully look at this example, we are storing the data with the lowest granularity. For every item number, we are storing how many units are being sold out and what is the profit. Okay, suppose we need to generate a report where instead of having granularity at the item number, if we want to item number and order date, if you want to see report month wise. See, in this table we are storing data for each item at date level. If you want to display a report to display data for item number at month level, what happens at the database is it would be taking all the day level details and summing up the values to get this kind of report. So there will be an overhead on database to calculate roll up value for each item number in a particular month. This leads to poor performance of query. Instead of that, if we have an aggregate table which where facts are summed up for selected dimensions. In this example, the facts are summed at dimension date, dimension at level month. The resulting aggregate table will have fewer rows, so queries can be executed in much faster way. So aggregate tables are those tables which have pre-computed values. Okay, so far we have seen what is an OLTP application, what is an OLAP application, okay, and what is the dimension modeling we use in OLAP application database, and what are the three types of schemas: star schema, snowflake, and fact translation. And apart from facts and dimension tables, so what other tables we see in data warehouse? We have seen all these things. Now this is the life cycle given by Kimball for data warehousing projects. Initially we would be planning for which process we would be creating this metadata. We would be gathering business requirements, simultaneously architecture and product selection installation would be done, and at the database level we would be creating a schema by taking some dimensional modeling technique and using ETL. Data from OLTP to OLAP would be transformed and loaded, and then we would be creating metadata on top of this database and reporting and analytics reports would be developed using OBA application. Then we can see after publishing these reports if there are any enhancements required. Again we go back to the starting point and see whatever necessary actions are to be taken to get the enhancements into the report. This is the life cycle given by Kimball. Kimball is like guru for data warehousing. With this I conclude the basic introduction for warehousing.